Hello and welcome back to the ROKER RAPPORT XTRA podcast in association with Rokes Brewery. Sunderland are utterly horrific at the time of speaking and I'm absolutely tired of being nice about it. We lost again, this time against Gillingham, following on from defeats to League 2 relegation candidate Scunthorpe and Leicester's 12-year-old children. Everyone hates everything and we've got players telling fans to get lost, for want of a better word. So I hope that you're suitably geared up for this half hour injection of positivity. If you are, sit down, grab a coffee, and hopefully we'll try and improve the mood this week. But to discuss Saturday's massive game for ourselves and also for Coventry, we've got Dominic from SidewaysSammy.com. How are you doing, Dom? Are you well?
Yeah, not too bad.
Good. Mood's better up in Coventry than I think, or should I say down in Coventry than it is in Sunderland. You are doing relatively well this season. I absolutely hate football, but my first question for you is, why do we even like football? It's completely pointless, isn't it?
Yeah, maybe I'm slightly masochist in this way, where I kind of view football as ultimately an unrewarding pastime. But it's really just about those small moments of glory where you can take it. Where I think when you're sitting watching your team chance another limb defeat, you just got to grin and bear it and just remember those good times not that far away, or just remember the ones that were before. I mean, obviously with Coventry, we went through a spell where we didn't finish in the top six of the league for nearly half a century. So it was just each year you're telling yourself that obviously, like some football clubs eventually somehow stumble their way to success, even if it's sort of one odd season out of nowhere, and it will eventually come. And it took dropping down to pretty much our lowest ebb in League Two for things to finally change and to learn that it is possible to have good times.
Yeah, I mean, you know, looking at the season that you have, and we're doing, maybe not by league position, doesn't look too bad, but you know, it's not gone anywhere near like we wanted it to this season. But Coventry sit third, despite having a bit of an odd summer where you actually lost, in my opinion, most of your better players, some of them to ourselves. But what's been going right in the Coventry ranks to make you succeed as well as you have done so far?
So it's been quite strange in that I don't think we have any particularly outstanding players at the moment. But it just seems that in every area of the pitch, we're just kind of decent enough, possibly just missing a goal scorer. I think the number one thing is that we sort of changed our style of play up a little bit this season. Definitely much more focused about building the play out from the back and holding on to the ball for long periods of the game. And it just seems that by sort of having long spells in possession, we're sort of limiting what the opposition can do to us, and then just generally through somehow from a variety of different sources really, we're putting the balls in the net enough to have a pretty positive record. I mean, it's quite a strange record. We've drawn a fair amount of games, most of them on the road. We actually haven't won an away game this season. Equally, we've only lost one away game. So it's still a little bit like this season, even though we're third place has yet to really take off. We haven't really thrashed anyone. We've just sort of been getting the job done, which has been a lot better than I expected, really, because as you mentioned, we've lost quite a few players over the summer. It was really a pretty new-looking squad heading into the new season, of course, playing at St. Andrews. We weren't really sure what kind of effect that had, but it just seems that Mark Robbins has done pretty well in just making things seem as normal as possible and just keeping things ticking over, really. It's sort of quite a normal experience watching us this season, and really circumstances that shouldn't be normal.
You mentioned about obviously the move to St Andrews, which was quite a big thing, I think, for any club. But you've actually been through it before, but I noticed that attendances had fallen a little bit for obvious reasons at the beginning of the season. Has the success of the team on the pitch or the league position, which indicates there's been a successful season, has that changed attendances at all at the ground, or has it still been like a steady sort of low amount?
Yeah, it still feels like sort of similar levels. It hasn't really changed that much. I think at the start of this season, when the weather was quite good, it was there was always quite a novelty about it. I live in Bowen, so I know sort of the area around St. is quite well. It's quite a nice number of sort of pubs and bars around there. So quite a nice place to go when it's nice and sunny and people sort of checking out for the first time. And just feel now that winter's hitting, that maybe we're starting to see a little bit of negative impact. I don't think the numbers have changed that much, but there's also issues at the moment with getting the train from Coventry to Birmingham, which could affect our tendencies over the winter. So it still feels like a amazing thing. Like when we played at Northampton for the first few months, there was getting that novelty factor, and their team was performing really well. It's possibly the best Coventry City team I've been to see. Playing regularly, had a Cam Wilson coming through, redeveloping that season. It was just such an attacking, swashbuckling side. This is quite different. It just doesn't feel as different to playing at the Rico Arena. We're sort of used to playing in quite a big stadium where it's not. It's about a third full, and this is only slightly less. So there's less of that shock factor. But I wonder whether over the course of the season, whether we might begin to see a bit of a more of the negative impact. But yeah, so far so good.
Talked about the team being almost completely new, and I mean, I can only judge it on the games we played against you last year, but when you look at the lineups, it's vastly changed. But there's three players in the Sunderland ranks at the moment, and if it was up to me, there would be four, because I wouldn't mind Tom Bayliss if he fancies coming on loan. But I noticed that you have obviously changed the team a bit, but we have got Jordan Willis, who was probably one of your more standout players over the past couple of years. Lee Burge, who was actually a little bit ridiculed by your fans before he came to ourselves. And Mark McNulty, who I think did very well for yourself. Now, to be honest, despite our poor performances of those three players, they're the ones that actually I think most fans quite like, especially with Willis and Burge. And McNulty, although he's been injured a lot, has actually done all right when he's came in. But what are your memories of like each individual player? Because I know that Lee Burge came with a bit of a bad tag, to be honest with you, and he's kind of proven us wrong a little bit, because we were a bit worried.
Yeah, so I've also seen before on Burge's side quite a lot of Coventry City fans. I think the problem for him was he came into the team when he was first making for his first 10 or 20 appearances. He was just too young to be a first choice goalkeeper. He was only really playing because the loan goalkeepers we tried to replace Joe Murphy with just weren't up to standard. So in his first game, Marcus Madison took a free kick from about 40 yards, which just flew over his head. She had a bit of a flap out. And in his second or third game, we were playing Worcester City in the FA Cup, and he picked up a red card. And it just seems the tide was against him right from when he kicked off his Coventry career. He's never able to fully convince a section of fans. He also played quite a big role in our Johnson's Paint Trophy and League Two promotion winning season. There's still a few errors along the way in the game, particularly, I think, when it comes to playing crosses at times, because he's someone who wants to hold on to the ball when playing crosses. He can miss, and Dalty just leads quite an easy goal for the opposition. I mean, as you saw in the 5-4 game, there was a couple of crosses. He had a flat out. But, he's quite a solid shot stopper. Maybe not the best with the ball at his feet. He can sort of hook balls played to him at his feet, so placing quite quickly and under pressure. That's when he seems to struggle. I think he's a bit of a confidence player. When his confidence is at the top, he can just be really, really strong, solid goalkeeper. And when it's not, it just isn't. He just fails to convince in anything. And I think for the final 6 months or so of his time with us, his confidence has just hit rock bottom. And it's probably just the time for him to have a bit of a change, really. It was a bit of a surprise to see him go to Sunderland. There was some talk about him going to a championship club. I wasn't really convinced that was the right move for him. I sort of saw him going to like a smaller League One or Two club and just being able to start somewhere with a blank slate and show what he's all about. But it's basically just going into a new environment, it's possibly done in the world good.
With Burge, it's been weird because like we've seen a totally different goalkeeper to what we were sort of told. He seems quite confident on crosses. His distribution's quite well. I wonder if it was just a fresh start that kind of helped him.
Yeah, I can imagine. So just always got helpers whenever he made errors. There was a number of games where if he made a save, he'd be ironically cheered. It was just absolutely toxic for him by the end.
Yeah, and I think there's a few. Unfortunately, there's a few players you can also probably see that with Sunderland as well. But Jordan Willis had a pretty poor debut, and then his game against Ipswich wasn't that great. But he scored against Portsmouth in the third game of the season, and truth be told, he's been our most consistent and probably our best defender, and has taken the captain's armband a couple of times, and quite impressed, to be completely honest, despite his. We've been that bad, but he's quite well liked. Jordan Willis at Coventry, he actually came through the ranks with yourselves and was part of that team that Lee Burge was part of that got you promoted and won the Johnson's Paint. But he's quite well liked, I think, isn't he?
Yeah, he was always just sort of a solid player, probably a 6 or 7 out of 10.
Yeah,
most weeks. So the one thing is, I possibly not the most commanding, but I think he makes up for that by being. Absolutely exceptionally quick.
Yeah.
So he's played higher up the pitch and also just been quite a determined character. He's sort of, there's never someone who could be stood out, but never really someone who let the team down. And someone who's played 200 games like that has obviously got something about them. And he's probably just reached the stage two where he just needs to take that next step in his career and possibly wasn't quite ready to make that. Move to the Championship, probably still has a few things to work on.
Yeah, very much so. I think, you know, the way you've described Jordan Willis is kind of how we see him. He can have a stinker, but it tends to be when the team has a stinker, he tends to be six or seven out of ten every single week. And I agree with what you're saying about him being commanding. It's very much about his pace and the way that he can basically make up for any mistakes that he does make by just covering back. And he actually complements one of our defenders, Joel Lynch, quite well. Although the form's terrible and everything is awful here and I hate football, Jordan Willis is probably the one alongside Luke O'Neill and that I can probably say has been doing quite well. But going into the match on Saturday, Sunderland have quite a few weird little rivalries, which I quite like. Truth be told, I think rivalry is always good. Portsmouth is probably one of them in this division, but Sunderland and Coventry have had it for a long, long time. Now, I remember 1997. I'll be honest, I don't remember before that, and it still rankles a little bit. But I'm always quite intrigued as to how Coventry fans view Sunderland, because there was a bit of aggro last year, i.e. things were thrown at our fans, I think, from your fans. And I think the rivalry that was there might have gone down a little bit because of the years that we haven't played each other, but it sort of stoked itself back again. So how do Coventry fans view Sunderland at the moment?
Yeah, I mean, I have to admit, it wasn't really something that was on my radar until possibly 4 or 5 years ago.
Yeah.
When I think it was like Coventry fans like trolling Sunderland forums, or you just see comments on social media and you sort of realise it's almost, well, you realise that there's a club up there who doesn't like your club in the slightest, and I think kind of took exception to that and not really having a rival club ourselves to play over the past 6 or 7 years since we were relegated from the Championship in 2012, when we'd be playing Leicester every year. It almost feels like we've been searching for a rival, and that sort of increased awareness of what Coventry means to Sunderland sort of created an intensity to it when we were finally playing each other last season. I wonder whether that same thing will be there this year, particularly in this game, considering that it's not such a large away attendance. It's about 1,200. So we're not bringing as big numbers. And I just wonder whether last season teams got out of hand a little bit, and
there may
be sort of stepping back from that, but could be interesting to see. Particularly, I think the game at possibly St Andrews, if we're still playing there in March, that could be quite an interesting one. Obviously, with the prospect that if Sunderland bring enough fans, they could well outnumber the home support.
Yeah, and we've done that. We've done that in this league a couple of times, and for various different reasons. I think the one that sticks out was Blackpool, but I think that was at the time when they were under the Oyston, so fully back their home fans for not going to that game, completely get that. With Coventry as well, I think you mentioned about you have, I think, 1,200 going. I don't actually know if this is true or not, but there was a lot of discussion when we had, when Stuart Donald had done talk-ins about sort of the situation that we had last year with Coventry and Portsmouth. I think Coventry was the original one where there was the things that were thrown over. And then there was an issue with Portsmouth who threw a flare into our end during the league game when we had like 41,000 there. And the family zone is kind of just underneath it. It's kind of not the sort of end where all the kind of grown men sit. It's actually the opposite, truth be told. You get a lot of families and things around that area. And there was a discussion around having like netting to make sure that didn't happen. I know there was a lot of talk around it and there's a lot of things in place that you can and can't do with away fans. And I think that's kind of one of the problems Stuart Donald was having, but it was a real pressing concern for a lot of Sunderland fans. One of the things I wanted to ask, did we actually reduce your allocation this year, or is it the same as last year, but you just didn't bring as many as you did last year?
I think it's a reduced one, but sort of the way the ticket sales are gone, I think last year, when it was the season ticket holder period for sales, basically just flew out all like 2,000 of them. Whereas this year, they got to general sale, which is about two rounds of like ticket purchasing.
Yeah.
So it just feels less of an interest in this game, possibly because the last one was sort of relatively close in time.
Yeah. Do you know what? I think, obviously, as much as a lot of fans are angry at Coventry for what they did, and I completely get that, and me as well, does it sometimes feel as well that there was the actions of a few kind of spoiled it for the majority, and you feel a little bit tainted?
Yeah, that, like, reading the report, and even around home games as well, when it was sort of scuffles outside, just left such a bitter taste in my mouth. It sort of took the shine off the victory slightly, if I'm honest. It's just like, who cares if another club doesn't like you? Why do you just have to? Why does that give you the right to act like a bit of a dickhead?
Yeah,
there is always that sort of section of people, I think, in most sort of away supports. But
we had it last year. We had it last year with Portsmouth and one of my good friends, Hugh, who does the PO4 podcast with Portsmouth. I hate Portsmouth. I've said this for a long time. I always have, and I probably always will since the start of that season. But in terms of, obviously, you may have seen the playoffs and obviously Luke O'Nine getting a kick and stuff like that when he went over the hoardings. And I think the funny thing was you see it from our perspective, and immediately I kind of hated Portsmouth because of that. I've seen what happened with Coventry, immediately disliked that, and obviously things in the past, the history with Sunderland and Coventry as well. But speaking of Hugh, you know, Hugh was saying, he was like, that actually really annoyed people. It didn't get shown, but we actually booed him. Like, when it happened, he's an embarrassment to the city and the club. And I think sometimes you don't see that side of it. And it's only fair, I think, to have another side of it as well, because it's very easy for me to be angry at Coventry. But I think it is very much the actions of a few rather than the majority. And it's a shame, because if there has been a reduced allocation, there is going to be genuine fans who would have wanted to come to that game where maybe they're not able to get tickets for it. But as it is, like you say, it's gone through a few different phases and actually it's gone the other way and maybe feels like people don't want to go because it was spoilt for them last year. So that's quite interesting. Onto your team itself, I did actually see someone in a Coventry shirt, I think last week, trying to masquerade as Lionel Messi, taking on just about seven or eight different players. Now, I promise you, if anyone hasn't seen the goal, it's Liam Walsh. He scored against, I think it was Rochdale. He literally takes the ball from the halfway line, beats about seven or eight players, and it's an absolute screamer, which probably should have had more coverage than it probably did. But I always do a section where I look at three players that I think are your key players. Who would you say the three players that Coventry should watch, and where do you think you can damage us at the weekend?
So, I think Liam Walsh has sort of stamped his mark on the team over the past couple of games. He's sort of a real ball-playing midfielder. His game's not really about bursting through midfield and beating four players. Like, you saw with that goal, sort of someone that I think generally wants to sit on the ball and pick a pass. But I think he has shown with that goal and a few moments as well that perhaps he's more a player who can play box to box, and someone who sits back a little. At times he's been playing as our most sort of deep line midfielder, and he's just not built to play that role. He's tiny, he's about 5'5". We'll hopefully have Liam Kelly back in the side. He's more of a defensive midfielder for this game, which will let him off the leash a little bit. I'd also watch out for our right wing back, Fankati Dabo, who is just an absolute fun player to watch. He's played with such manic energy, covers a lot of ground, does a tackle, charges forward. He's got a good cross in him. And sort of similar on the other side to, with Brandon Mason. So at the moment, we don't really have much of a attack force to speak of. We've got, I think, 3 strikers injured and another one suspended. So it's mainly about our midfield and those wing backs.
I was looking through, I did like a preview at the beginning of the season, and I looked through players like that would be a key player, I thought. And because you'd lost that many players, the one person that stuck out for me was Wesley, I think it's Wesley Joblo, I think is it pronounced. Well, I looked at his stats, he's played about 11 games, but he hasn't really, on the basis of statistics, I don't watch him every week, but hasn't seemed to have hit the ground running as much as I thought. How's he been performing?
Yeah, so he picked up an ACL injury at the start of October, so he hasn't been playing. He's sort of possibly sort of 6 out of 10 player when I saw him.
Yeah.
He was playing a 4-3-3, and he was playing on the right of it. And he's more sort of an out-and-out winger.
Yeah.
So he just wants to stay wide and ping crosses into the box, which he did quite reliably. There was just that quality with the where he was crossing. He's sort of slightly kind of minus player, but someone you could sort of rely on to do his job, and as long as you sort of had a system in which to contain that,
yeah,
he was a reasonably effective player.
Yeah. We've discussed it already a little bit about, you know, Coventry's fate. Relatively similar to Sunderland's in the way that you sort of went from the Premiership where you'd been for a long, long time and then just kind of fell through this kind of massive trap door through the leagues. I think a lot of people have watched it, and I don't know if you have, but I know our Netflix documentary went down for good and bad reasons, really. Some people like to watch it to find it funny. Some people watched it as a genuine documentary, and I think me, myself, actually really enjoyed it as a Sunderland fan. But did you watch any of that Netflix series? And if you did any of it feel quite familiar?
Yeah, I have to admit, I watched it just to as I'm watching a car crash.
Yeah,
by side of the road.
Yeah,
but I suppose one of the main things that was interesting from a commentary perspective was the period where Chris Coleman was in charge. It was just quite interesting because I absolutely hated him from his spell with us. Sort of was someone who had a reputation that didn't match his managerial talents. And so you kind of forget that they're also human as well. So it's interesting to just see sort of how personal he was. But then it was quite telling. There was a talking head, wasn't there, with Aidan McGeady.
Yeah.
Where he basically came out and said players weren't getting that much tactical instruction from him. And
yeah,
that's kind of untrue based on watching his team play football over a period of a few years. I suppose that sort of tumbling out of the top flight thing, it just took so long for us to reverse. It just felt like we're sort of stumbling from place to place, just hoping there'd be a solution. There didn't really seem to be much of a plan the way we went about things. Sort of had the first season where we were spending a bit of money, which it turns out we didn't really have. And then afterwards, we were just always sort of cost cutting and trying to find the short term solution, trying to hire a manager who had success a few years earlier, and just took that shock and awe of being in these two probably for a reverse. There's always through that thing you always think to yourself, oh, it can't get worse, and sorry, the thing with football always counts. There's always relegation places available, and you've got to try and fight as hard as you can to avoid complacency, and so you've got to get lucky as well with finding the right manager. I mean, got Mark Fromm's in charge, but if you look at his track record elsewhere, it doesn't immediately scream out to you this is the man who could turn around Coventry City. Aside from having a really good first spell with us, which is about 5 months long, which couldn't really accurately judge him from, it was a bit of luck that he just turned out to be the right man at the right time.
It's funny you mentioned about Chris Coleman, because I think a lot of Sunderland fans, when he first came in, felt that he was the right character. I think that there's a kind of an in-joke between me and a couple of mates, and I think probably some other mates as well, unbeknown to myself, where it was like, Chris Coleman, he gets it. And it's like, it felt like he got it, and he had that sort of passion. He came in from a really, really good record at Wales, where he'd basically taken them further than anyone had before. Now, we've obviously recently changed our manager, and it's funny you mentioned about Coleman being at Coventry as well, which kind of completely skipped my mind. Now, he took you, as far as I'm aware, at that point to the lowest league finish in more than 45 years, and I think he got relegated 2 years later. So it was almost like, I don't want to put the blame on him for that because I don't know enough about it, but I don't think he was that successful, and you've sort of echoed that as well. But back to the point about maybe ourselves, in terms of appointing Phil Parkinson, and he has a good track record at this level, as far as we can see. Not with Colchester in the Championship, as Charlie Methven incorrectly pointed out, which I will point out. But he did obviously have a really, really good League One pedigree, shall we say. Now, I was very much of the opinion that it should be someone who could bring in a character and a personality that suited Sunderland. And I very much felt like Kevin Phillips would be a good choice. I think a lot of people felt like Roy Keane would be a good choice. And sometimes it's all about having the right kind of character at the right club, as opposed to having a good pedigree, I suppose. And I think when you look at Chris Coleman, how well he did at Wales, it's almost like he suited Wales perfectly. Mark Robbins is suiting Coventry perfectly, and we're still searching for the person that suits ourselves perfectly as well. With Sunderland's situation at the moment and Parkinson and things like that, have you been quite surprised at how badly Parkinson started the season?
Yeah, it'd still be early today, but you would have thought that Phil Parkinson is the kind of manager he could have come in and had a short-term impact. Just wonder whether the squad available is quite the kind of squad that Phil Parkinson excels with. From watching, like, seeing Coventry come up against the teams that he's managed, sort of very back-to-basics approach,
yeah.
I'd say, where I think he values players who just work their tops off. Obviously, he likes having a target man. But just wonder whether Sunderland's squad is a bit sort of there's a few sort of maverick characters in there, people who sort of want the team to be built around, and whether that's quite the kind of fit with Phil Parkinson. But as I say, it's still early days. I think he is kind of the first manager who's shown that when given enough time, generally makes a success of things. So. But those early results, particularly in cup competition, obviously haven't set him up well at all. That's what makes this game on Saturday quite an important one for him.
Yeah, it's huge, I think. I think Saturday's game's paramount. Even I think we're 9 games into his or 10 games into his Sunderland career, and I think we've lost 6 or 7 of them. I can't remember the exact stats. It's not good, put it that way, and I think people have pinpointed Saturday's game as absolutely huge, and then we got a rearranged game against Burton at home on the Tuesday, so the next 2 games are absolutely paramount. But it's very easy for me to say I don't think there's any players that you should be worried about coming up on Saturday, because that's just kind of the mood that I'm in and I think the fan base is in. But it's very easy to look from an insular viewpoint of, you know, none of the players are performing that well. But which players are Coventry fans a little bit worried about, i.e. where do you feel you're weakest, and where do you think we're strongest, and where do you think we could potentially damage you?
So I think the biggest Achilles heel of the team, aside from not being clinical in front of the goal, is that we do like taking on risks playing out from the back. So I think any forward who can play with energy and really sort of unsettle us is going to cause us problems. So, from what I understand, someone like Duncan Watmore, who will try and hassle us and cause problems, I think sort of depends on the way you set up. I think if you sort of go for the juggler and knock us out of our rhythm, that's where you're going to find joy. Also, think as well, our goalkeeper, Marco Moreschi, even though he's generally been quite solid this season, just still suspect he's quite weak on crosses. He's the type of keeper who will try and go and like punch across the way rather than claim it, which can lead to rebounds. I just don't think he's that confident claiming them. So I think anyone who can put a decent ball in and anyone who can get on the end of a cross, that's going to be another area to pinpoint. I think when we played Rotherham back in October, we just weren't set up to take on a team who were going to press us high at the pitch and force those errors. So I think stylistically, that's what Sunderland should be looking to do against us.
So just to kind of finish off then, I suppose, as always, we'll go score predictions, but I'll go mine first. I can see Coventry winning it 3-1. I think you'll have too much for us in terms of pace, physicality and on the break. And I think it could be potentially really toxic from the first minute for the right or wrong reasons on Saturday. But just to finish off, how do you feel the game's going to go on Saturday? What is your prediction?
I am being pessimistic too. I just got to say, those quite a few ex-Coventry players in the team sort of brings out the superstition in fans. So
it does.
I reckon this might be where you see something click a little bit for Phil Parkinson, and it might be like a 2-1 win for Sunderland.
I'll take that. I'll take that in a heartbeat. But Dom, thanks very much for popping on.
Okay.
I hope you don't enjoy Saturday too much, but that's just honesty. But enjoy the rest of the season. Thanks for coming on as always, and
All right.
Feel free to stay in touch. Thanks, mate.
Cheers.